Good morning, folks. I'm glad you could join us here today for this video broadcast. I certainly miss gathering together with you on Sunday mornings, but I guess this is how we have to do it for now. Let me start by inviting you to take a moment to grab a piece of bread and a glass of juice, grape juice, or any other juice that you can find. We're going to celebrate communion together this morning, a little later in the morning. John is going to come and is going to pray with us in just a few moments, but let me update you on a few things before we get started. First of all, there are a few people who are willing to help you with your needs, if you have any. Folks in our church that have volunteered to take groceries to you or fetch some medicines for you if you need that kind of help. Just phone and let me know and we'll get that set up. And also, if you'd like to be a part of that ministry, just phone and let me know that as well, and we'll add you to the list. Secondly, please pray for a young family in our community who just lost their home in a fire. I've been in touch with them. They're living in a hotel at the moment. Their insurance company is going to pay for that, but they have otherwise no place to live. It's hard to find things in this environment, and so they're not quite sure what their future holds. So if you'd be in prayer for them, their first names are Patience and Francis. And so if you can think of any way that you could help them, please let me know and I'll certainly pass that on to them. Thirdly, I want to remind you to continue to give financially to our ministry here. Even though we're not meeting together, we're still trying to be a ministry to our community here and to others around the world. And so if you would like to give your tithes and offerings to our church ministry during this difficult time, there are two ways to do that. You can e-transfer to our church email address online, or if you'd prefer, you can bring something by the office. I'm here Tuesdays through Fridays from 10:30 to 4:30, and you can just stop in. There's a little box on the wall beside my office marked offerings, and you can put your offering in there. And we'll make sure that we process that for you. And then fourthly, let's remember to pray for each other during these weird and sometimes lonely days. It's not always easy for some of us to be alone. And so I want to invite you to make those phone calls that maybe you haven't made for a while and just stay in touch with each other that way. Maybe you can FaceTime with people, but let's try and stay communicating with each other as much as possible from the safety of our homes. So I hope you'll take advantage of that in the weeks to come. Let's pray together and then we'll begin. Father in heaven, these are difficult days, rather strange for all of us. But we thank you, Lord, that you are a God who never changes and that we can always place our faith in you and our hope in you. We pray, Lord, again for your protection over our community and over each other and our community of faith here at Northwest Community Church. Pray, Father, for the needs that we've just spoken about, and pray that you will continue to work in the lives of those people. And as we gather together here online, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for all that he means to us. And it's a delight for us, Lord, to gather together with our families in our homes and continue to celebrate our love for you. And so we pray that we would sense your presence with us today. And we pray it in Jesus' name and for his glory. Amen. Thank you.
morning, everyone. Or if you slept in, I guess, good afternoon. And welcome to our mini service broadcast this morning. It does feel strange looking into the camera. I'm used to looking around when I speak to you, but I guess you guys are in there now, so I could speak to you. And anyways, but just want to say before I start that I really miss all of you. I miss worshiping with you guys. I miss talking with you guys. I even miss Jim's corny jokes here. But it is it has been difficult not to come to church on Sunday and be with all of you. But this is our situation. It's the same for all the churches here in town, and all the churches in the world, I guess. And it's, I guess, our new normal. And we're doing what we can to keep a connection with you and encourage you. These days, many of you have been staying at home. I mean, we're supposed to stay at home. If some of you already, your job is gone maybe now, and you're home with your family, and you're without a paycheck. And of course, there's some of you who are still working, and you're worried about losing your job, but at the same time, you're worried about going to work, because then you'll be in contact with so many people and be exposed to the virus. And this is kind of a new and frightening experience for all of us. And we know that everybody has some level of anxiety and fear. So this is a good time to pray. Okay, so let's pray. Lord God, we thank you that you are good, loving God. And Father, we know that you are always close, and your promises and your word are real, that you are here with us through all of this, Lord God. And we praise the Lord and thank you for good things that are going on, and we're going to be asking for your help, Lord, through some of the difficulties. And we praise you for that Henry is cold is getting better, but even more relief to him was the fact that he doesn't have cancer. And we really praise you for that. We pray for Joel and Kylie and their little one, Emily, who I think is doing fine. Lord God, please protect them. I pray that this virus will not come around and that you, Lord God, that you can encourage them through this difficult time. Father, I also pray for Gerald Siebert's girlfriend, Karen. She has cancer, and she's going through chemo right now. She has a weak immunity, and I pray, Father, that you would keep her safe and draw her close to you. We also pray for Milton as well, who also has weak immunity, and that you would keep him safe from this virus. Lord, there's a young family in town. I don't know who they are, but their house just burnt down, Father, and they need a place to stay. I pray you provide a place for them and also provide people who are willing to help them. Lord, there's people in our church, in our community, who are suffering. Some are in isolation, Lord God, and I know there must be loneliness and anxiety and even depression, Lord God. Lord, I pray that you would be their strength and their security. And I also pray, Lord, that they would look to you for comfort and that they would draw near to you in this difficult time. Father, I pray for families. And Lord, I thank you for this wonderful opportunity you've provided in this nation and in the whole world, for a chance for families to come together, Lord God, I know that can cause a lot of difficulties, Lord, but oh, so many good things can come from that. And I pray, Lord, that this is part of your will, Lord, that you're going to strengthen the family, husbands and wives reconnect together and learn to talk to each other more, and families can play together and pray together. And I just pray, Lord, that this family bond, Lord, will grow in the families of this congregation, this town, country, and even in the world, Lord God. And I thank you, Lord, help us to look for opportunities to help one another, to encourage one another, and of course to pray for one another. Lord, you are in this situation, and we believe that every difficulty, every trial, every storm in our life has purpose. We don't always know what that purpose is, but you do. You are calling us to be faithful and trust that you are working out your will through this difficult and trying time. We know that you love us, and we know that you know what is best for us. Forgive us, Lord, for our desire to always have an easy and comfortable life. Sometimes to hear you better and be close to you, you have to remove some of this comfort and allow uncertainty and discomfort so we can realize that you are all we need. In your grace is sufficient. Lord God, you are a good, good Father. And just like a child, when he is fearful or anxious, will run into the arms of his mother or father and feel security and peace. Lord God, may we this time run into your arms, and that we may know that we are secure in your arms, and we are at peace in your arms. It is you, Lord, that goes before us. You will not fail us or forsake us. We do not need to fear be discouraged. Amen. God bless you. Scripture reading today is from one of my favorite books. And it's from Isaiah 53, 5 to 12. But he was pierced for our rebellion, crushed for our sins. He was beaten so we would be whole. He was whipped so we would be healed. All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's path to follow our own. Yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all. He was oppressed and treated harshly, yet he never said a word. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep is silent before the shearers, he did not open his mouth. Unjustly condemned, he was led away. No one cared that he died without descendants, that his life was cut short in midstream, but he was struck down for the rebellion of my people. He had done no wrong and had never deceived anyone, but he was buried like a criminal. He was put in a rich man's grave. But it was the Lord's good plan to crush him and cause him grief. Yet when his life is made an offering for sin, he will have many descendants. He will enjoy a long life, and the Lord's good plan will prosper in his hands. When he sees all that he's accomplished by his anguish, he will be satisfied. And because of his experience, my righteous servant will make it possible for many to be counted righteous, for he will bear all their sins. I will give him the honor of a victorious soldier because he poured out his soul to death. He was counted among the rebels, yet he bore the sins of many and interceded for the rebels. God bless you all.
Stories of the Bible. Noah and the flood. This is Noah.
Hi.
Noah was a good man who tried to do the right thing.
Yeah.
But in the time when Noah lived, he was the only man on earth who was doing the right thing. All the other people on earth were doing evil things and hurting each other. This made God very sad. So God said that he was going to send a flood to the earth that would destroy every living thing on earth because he was sorry he ever made them. But God decided to save Noah and his family. God told Noah to build a boat and fill it with two of every kind of animal and bird. Noah did just that, and then Noah and his whole family boarded the boat and waited for the flood to come. The rain fell hard for 40 days and 40 nights. Water covered the whole earth, and the boat floated safely on the surface. Water covered even the highest mountains on earth, but Noah and his family were saved. God remembered Noah and all the animals on the boat. God sent a wind to blow across the earth, and the flood began to go away. After 5 months, the boat came to rest on a mountaintop. A few months later, the other mountains could be seen. 40 days later, Noah opened a window and released the raven. The bird flew back and forth until the flood had dried up. He also sent a dove out to see if it could find dry ground, but the dove couldn't find a place to land because there was still water on the ground. So the dove returned to the boat.
Oh, hello, Dad.
After another 7 days, Noah sent the dove out again. This time, it came back with an olive leaf.
Oh, good girl.
So Noah knew that the floodwaters were almost gone. A week later, he sent the dove out again, and it didn't come back. So many months after the flood began, Noah opened the covering of the boat and saw that the ground was dry. He waited 2 more months, and at last, the earth was dry. Then God said to Noah, "Leave the boat, all of you. Release the animals so they can be fruitful and multiply throughout the earth."
Okay.
So Noah, his family, and all the animals finally left the boat.
See ya.
Noah built an altar to the Lord to make a sacrifice to God. God was pleased with Noah's offering and said to himself that he would never again destroy every living thing on earth. God blessed Noah and his sons and promised them that he would never send another flood. He gave them the rainbow in the sky as a sign of this promise to Noah, his family, and all of mankind.
Well, I wish that we could be together this Easter season, but it's looking like that probably won't happen. But I do want to invite you to keep coming back to this place every Sunday morning at 10:30 to gather together with God and with His Word. I know it's not the same thing as being together as a church family and as a community here in Meadow Lake, but it's the next best thing that we have. This whole social distancing thing is a great reminder that the church really isn't a building. The church is the people of God wherever we are. And you know, for many people in this world, this is pretty normal stuff. they don't get to meet together in a building. It's too dangerous for them. Governments like China and Iran and in other Muslim countries don't allow it. But they carry on and they do it in isolation, just like we're being forced to do right now. And so in that sense, we sort of share in what they have been doing for centuries, some of them, under the hand of persecution. But I'm glad you're here with us today. You might not be aware, or maybe you are, but this is the fifth Sunday of Lent, which is a season for us to celebrate the events that led up to Easter weekend. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and I hope that you'll join me here again next Sunday at 10:30 in the morning for that. I've been trying to look at the seven sayings of Jesus from the cross during the last few Lenten Sundays, and this morning we're going to look at another set of his words from the cross, and I call this his words of desolation. His words of desolation. So I want you to take your Bibles and turn with me to Mark chapter 15, and we're going to read from verses 33 to 39 together. Mark 15, verses 33 to 39. At the sixth hour, darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani?" Which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And when some of those standing near him heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." One man ran and filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a stick, and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Leave him alone now. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus heard his cry and saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Several Sundays ago, we reflected on the first words out of the Savior's mouth at the cross when he said, "Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing." Jesus was living out what he preached his whole life. Love your enemies, forgive them, pray for them, and do good to them. And here he is in his dying hours while they're driving spikes through his hands and through his feet. And he is praying for his enemies just like he had taught his disciples to do. "Father, forgive them. They don't understand what they're doing." Powerful words. And then we looked at his words of hope as he hung there between two convicted criminals. If you remember, there was one on his left and there was one on his right. The one on the left was very vulgar and was full of hate and full of blame and was completely unrepentant, which is the way too many people enter into eternity. But then the one that was on his right was a criminal who had owned up to his own sins and had put his faith in Jesus Christ. And he asked Jesus, "Lord, remember me when you come back with your kingdom." And Jesus said, "My friend, today, because of your faith, you will be with me in paradise." And that brings us now to verse 33. 3 hours had passed since they'd nailed Christ to that cross. And just like some people are suffering with COVID right now, his breathing was getting really hard and labored. The hot sun of Palestine had been beating down on him for 3 hours with unrelenting fever heat. And the pain was so unbearable. You see, when they hung you on a cross in those days, they would tilt you slightly forward, which would increase the agony of your flesh and would make it hard for you to breathe or to push up with your feet. And so most criminals simply suffocated after a few hours of agony. It was a horrible way for a man to die. And then the Bible says that at the sixth hour, which was 12 noon, a darkness came over the land until 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And those were the three darkest hours of the Savior's life. There he hung in naked judgment. Not for his own sins, because he didn't have any. He was the perfect Son of God. But But he was hanging there with all of our sins from every generation placed upon him. And his heavenly Father turned his face away from his Son. For the first time in his eternal existence, the Son of God felt the judgment of his Father, not for his own sins, but for ours. For the Lord had laid the iniquity of us all on him, Isaiah says. Paul says in 2 Corinthians, for God made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, so that in him, through faith, we might become the righteousness of God. In other words, Jesus was taking the hit from God for us so that we wouldn't have to. And when we put our faith in that, God declares us to be innocent and to be free of his judgment and to be righteous in Jesus Christ. We've talked lots around here about through faith in Christ, God takes us in all of our sin and he places us into the righteousness of Jesus Christ, where we remain safe. And when God looks at us, he sees the righteousness of his Son. Peter said Christ himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we can die to our sins and live for righteousness. For it's by his wounds that you have been healed. And those 3 hours that he spent in darkness on the cross were the worst 3 hours of his life. They were absolute agony of heart and of soul for the Son of God, because for the first time in all of eternity, he was experiencing the abandonment and the displeasure of his Father. And he hung there after 6 hours on the cross and he cried out, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? And I know that some of you have experienced rejection too by people that cared about you, or you thought they did. Maybe it was a spouse or a best friend or a boss. But you know, this was way worse. Some of you may have been abandoned by your birth parents, but this was way worse. The Bible says he was despised and rejected by men. He was a man of suffering and familiar with pain. Like one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Jesus had been rejected and forsaken by virtually everybody in his life before this event happened at the cross. You know, his own blood brothers had mocked him and had refused to believe in him. His hometown had tried to kill him. The nation that he had come to save had rejected him. And most of his followers had left him when he started talking about eating flesh and drinking blood. And his own mother began to think that he was insane. Judas, one of his disciples, betrayed him. And Peter denied him. And in the end, the rest of his disciples turned around and the Bible says they fled away from him. He was despised and he was forsaken by men. And we held him in low esteem. And now here he is in the toughest 3 hours of his life. And he cries out, my God, oh mighty God, why have you forsaken me? For the first time in his eternal existence, Jesus had no fellowship with his Holy Father. And it may be that you're feeling that way yourself. It might be that events in your life have made it hard for you to love God or to trust him anymore. And you've been asking, why, Lord? Why? Why have you abandoned me? You might be seeing at home these days, shuttered away by our government officials and our church leaders. Cut off from people you work with and people that you worship with and people you enjoy being around. You don't get to go to church. You don't get to go to work. Your favorite restaurants are closed. You don't get to visit with your neighbors. You might be losing your jobs. Maybe you've lost a big part of your investments for your retirement, and you're sitting at home wondering what the future holds. There may be some of you that are worried sick about this coronavirus, and you're worried that you'll get it and you'll be dead soon. And you're wondering, why, God, why? Why have you forsaken us? For Jesus, it was because he was carrying all of our sin at the cross. Galatians 3:13 says, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. And God was cursing him there. All of the punishment that we deserve was falling on Jesus. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung upon a tree. And Isaiah says, surely he took up our pain and he bore our suffering, and yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted for his own sins, even though he didn't have any. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. And the punishment that brought us peace was placed upon him by God, and by his wounds we are healed. For all of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on Jesus the iniquity of us all. God had turned his face away because in the perfection of his holiness, he can't possibly fellowship with sinful people. And Jesus had become sin for us. This is why God had tossed the rebellious angels out of heaven. God cannot fellowship with sinners, not the way that we are. And so the entire sin of the world from every generation is placed on the perfect Son of God. Why? Because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son as a sacrifice for us, to take the hit for us. God laid the iniquity of us all on him, the Bible says, and God punished Jesus so that he won't have to punish you. And in the moment of that torment, Jesus cries out, God, why have you forsaken me? I mean, it's the lament of a soul that is lost and is broken. And it's what will come out of your mouth again and again and again and again if you refuse to repent and receive Christ's sacrifice for you. God will be forced to judge you for your own sins, because you refuse to accept his judgment on Jesus for your sins. And he'll remove you from any kind of fellowship with him forever and ever and ever, the Bible says. God is a God of love, there's no question. Yes, that's true. But he is also a God of holiness and perfection, a God who hates sin and who punishes sin. I've heard people over the last couple of weeks wonder why God would allow a plague like this to threaten our planet. The answer's in his word, like it always is. It's in his word and it's in his holy character. The Bible says, your eyes are too pure to look on evil. You can't tolerate wrongdoing. And in Noah's time, it had gotten so bad, just like we saw in that children's feature, it had gotten so bad that God saw the wickedness of man, and that it was great and it was unrelenting on the earth, and that every imagination of man's heart was only evil all the time. And so God made the decision to wipe man from the face of the planet, except for Noah and for his family, with whom he would start all over again. The Bible says that a man who remains stiff-necked after much reproof will suddenly be shattered beyond recovery. The book of Revelation talks about God sending out plagues at the end of time to scorch our sinful world. And it says that they will call God wicked names, even when he has the power over these kinds of troubles to stop it. And they will not be sorry for their sins, and they will not turn from them and honor him. And my goodness, I'm scared that we're kind of in that time right now. I wonder how many people on this planet are turning to God and turning to Christ and saying, forgive me, Lord. The Bible says that he's willing to forgive our sins and turn away from the impact of this coronavirus. When I shut up the heavens so that there's no rain, or I command locusts to devour the land or send a plague among my people, if my people who are called by my name, that's us, that's Christians, we talked about this last week. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and will pray and will seek my face and will turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and I will heal their land. Is that what you're spending a little bit of time doing while you stay at home? This is a promise from God to his people for a time like this. But it's only a temporary thing. This virus is a reminder to everybody that God can unleash his judgment on this world at any time, and there is nothing we can do to turn it back. We can try to hide from it. We can try to escape from it. Jesus says in Matthew that the time will come when judgment finally comes upon the world, and people will be hiding under rocks and will be hiding everywhere to escape from this judgment, and they won't be able to. There's a day of ultimate judgment coming. And we'd better be ready for it. We had better be covered by the shed blood of our Savior at the cross through faith in him. The Bible says, once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. And that's why God sends these judgments on this world from time to time. But now, he has offered to reconcile you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish, and free from accusation if you continue in your faith, established and firm, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel. God offers us a way out. Have you taken it? Have you placed your faith in Christ? These words of desolation that Jesus utters at the cross are a painful reminder that God's judgment against sin is a horrible, tormenting thing. Eloi! Eloi! Lama sabachthani! And it was at that moment that Christ went through hell for us, where God judges us and he banishes us from his presence. And for a moment, the Son of God experienced that. But because he loves us too, he offers us a remedy from all of this through faith in Christ. For God was pleased to have all of his fullness dwell in Jesus, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. He took the hit for us, if we will only receive it. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. And that's what we celebrate at communion. The shed blood of Jesus Christ, which remits our sins, which washes us clean, and places us before God the Father in the perfection of Jesus Christ. The Bible says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. And Father, I pray that as we sit at home, shuttered away, for those of us who have received this gift from you, that we would celebrate it often and thank you every day. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you were willing to lay your life down at the cross. We thank you that you modeled what you always preached. We thank you that you were willing to forgive your enemies even as they drove spikes through your hands. We thank you that you forgave the repentant sinner at the cross. It reminds us that we can always come before you and repent. I pray, Lord, if there are people that are listening here today that have never taken that step, that they will take it now. This virus comes closer and closer to our door. Are we ready? Are we ready for what you have in mind for our future? You may have a glorious future in mind for us here on planet Earth, or these may be the last few weeks of our life. We don't know. But Father, I pray that you would find us ready. I pray that your Spirit will pour out upon our community here in Meadow Lake, across our province, across our Canada, our country, and around the world. And that there will be a great spiritual awakening as people realize that at any time you can change everything. And we're powerless to do anything about it except hide. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you've made it possible for when that final judgment does come, that if we are, through faith in you, covered by your blood and covered by the punishment that you were willing to take in our place, we will not be judged and we will have eternal life with you. Thank you for that gift. And I pray it for everyone. And I pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Jesus and his disciples spent some time together on a Thursday evening, right before the events that would unfold that we just talked about a little bit earlier. And so they shared a last meal together. The disciples had no idea what was coming, but Jesus knew. And he knew that he would be going to the cross to bear our sins and to take God's punishment for us. And so he began the meal like this. The Bible says that he took a loaf of bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This bread is my body, which I am giving for you. I want you to do this in remembrance of me." And then he reached for a glass of wine, and he said, "In the same way also, this cup represents my blood, which I am about to shed for you for the remission of your sins. Do this as often as you remember me." For as often as we eat this bread and we drink from this cup, we proclaim the death and the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ until he returns. Thank you for joining us here this morning. I trust that God will bless you and will keep you in the week ahead. And Father, I pray that you will keep us safe as we practice this social distancing. We pray again for our world. We pray that your hand would relent and that this virus might be over soon. But we also pray that you would search our hearts and that you would bring around a spiritual awakening and a revival that is so desperately needed on this planet. We thank you for the opportunity we've had to worship together this morning. We thank you, Lord, that no matter where we are, whether it's in a church building or at home or in our bedroom, kneeling down beside our bed, you are there and we can speak to you, and you listen and you speak to us through your word. So I pray your blessing upon your people everywhere, especially our people here in Meadow Lake. May they sense your presence in the days to come until we meet again. Now may the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.